We have seen thus far that the optical flow estimation problem is an under-constraint problem. The Lucas-Kanade method uses the assumption that the optical flow in a very small neighborhood in the scene is the same for all points within that neighborhood, and uses that assumption to then solve for the optical flow. So let's take a look at how that works. We're going to assume that for each pixel, the motion field, and hence the optical flow, is constant within a small neighborhood around that pixel. Neighborhood, we'll call that W. So let's say that we have a patch here in the image, a small patch, smaller the better, small patch right here. We're going to assume that all the points within this patch are moving the same way in the image. In other words, they produce the same motion field and hence the same optical flow in the image. So if that's the case, for each point within this window, let's say we take the point KL, we have the derivative of the intensity in the x direction times u plus the derivative of the intensity in the y direction times v plus the derivative in the time direction is equal to zero. And so that's one constraint that we have for the point KL. But since we have many points inside here, we're going to get a system of equations. We're going to get a large system of equations where the number of equations is going to be equal to the number of points inside the window W. Now, one of the interesting questions is why does this work? Well, it works because all of these equations, we hope, are not linearly dependent on each other. And the reason they tend not to be is because if you have a patch that has interesting enough texture, the derivatives Ix and Iy will most likely be different from pixel to pixel. So these are the equations that you get, and you can stack them up and then write it in matrix form as follows. And here you have this known matrix A, which is n squared. The window we said is n by n, so it's n squared by 2. That's this matrix. You have your unknown vector here, u. This is what we're trying to find for the window. That's optical flow. And then you have your known vector on the right-hand side, which is, again, n squared by 1. So you have n squared equations, and you have two unknowns. We know how to solve this problem. It's the least square solution. So let's take a look at that. We have A u equal to B. We take A transpose A times u equal to A transpose B. And we know how to do this. We simply find the inverse of this. So this is the same written in matrix form right here with all the elements. And we take the inverse of A transpose A, and we can find a solution for u. This is very easy, very fast, particularly because A transpose A is a 2x2 matrix. And here are the elements within A transpose A. These are all functions of the spatial derivatives. That's interesting, Ix and Iy. You don't have the time derivative in this matrix right here. The time derivative shows up in B, the vector on the right-hand side. So this is a very simple thing to do, and the question to ask is, when does this not work? When do we have problems? Well, we know that it's not going to work when A transpose A is not invertible. Another way to think about it is that A transpose A is not well conditioned. So what does that really mean? What is a well-conditioned system? Let's say you have some system which has an input and an output. A well-conditioned system is one where you have a significant enough change in the output for a change in the input. When that is the case, you can take changes in the output. You can take the output and estimate the input well enough. If you change the input and nothing happens in the output, then that's not a well-conditioned system. So even when you have a simple system such as this, A u equal to B, in this particular case, it is going to be a well-conditioned, if the matrix A transpose A is well-conditioned, then you're going to have a good, robust, reliable solution for the optical flow U. And when is A transpose A well conditioned? When the eigenvalues, remember this is a 2x2 matrix, the two eigenvalues, lambda 1 and lambda 2, both are significant enough, neither one is close to zero, and you can have one greater than the other, which will often happen, but one cannot be significantly larger than the other one. So let's sort of visually take a look at how this manifests in real images and what's really going on here in terms of this matrix A transpose A. Well, let's take a look at this scenario here where you have basically a textureless patch in the scene, and we want to compute the optical flow right here. Well, this is what the patch looks like, and if you look at the spatial gradients Ix and Iy, and you simply plot them, that is, you're taking two images, but you take the first image and compute the spatial gradients, these are the spatial gradients right here. They're all close to zero, as expected, because there's not much texture in this window right here. And so the way to visualize the condition number and how good the matrix A transpose A is that you take all of these points in Ix, Iy space and imagine fitting an ellipse to it. And that is the best fit ellipse that you see here, happens to be close to a circle in this case. The semi-major axis and semi-minor axis of this ellipse that you fit correspond to the eigenvalues lambda 1 and lambda 2 of the matrix A transpose A. So if lambda 1 and lambda 2 are really small, which is the way it's turning out in this case because all the gradients are very small, then you're not going to be able to compute optical flow reliably. This should not surprise you. When you have no texture to hang on to, your derivatives are all small, clearly estimating optical flow is going to be small, very difficult. And that applies to us as well. If I show you a scene or a surface patch which has no texture and I move it, well, it looks pretty much the same even after the motion, any local patch within it. So it cannot be estimated reliably. So that's what I would call a bad region. There's another type of bad region where you have an edge. So an edge, of course, has a very clear visual feature. But when you look at the gradients in this case, you have strong gradients in one direction, but you have weak gradients in the other direction. So the problem really here is that if you have this edge, it's very hard to know whether the edge actually moved this way or it's actually moving diagonally this way even faster. So both of them will produce the same apparent changes in the brightness in the two different images. And so this is again badly conditioned because in this particular case, one eigenvalue is significantly larger than the other one. Again, cannot be computed, optical flow cannot be computed reliably. This corresponds to the aperture problem we talked about earlier. So the sort of good case for us is when you have rich texture. When you have texture that looks like this, we have lots of different brightness values or changes in brightness in both the directions, then you can imagine that when you find the spatial derivatives Ix and Iy, they're going to be scattered and you're going to get large eigenvalues. And therefore, the matrix A transpose A is well conditioned and the optical flow that you end up computing is going to be reliable.